Great. Well, welcome back from the break. We're going to move into the next section about the future of information architecture. We talked a little bit about the past, a little bit about the present. We've got two special speakers here today for this session. The first is Peter Morville, and the second is Carl Fast. And I'll let them introduce themselves a little bit and take us on to the next part of the day. Thank you.
Well, thanks, Keith, and thanks to all of you for being here today. The plan for this session is for me to take 20 minutes, for Carl to take 20 minutes, and then we'll have 20 minutes for Q&A. My first prediction about the future is that neither of us will stick to our 20-minute slots, but you can time us and let me know if my prediction's accurate. So I'm going to move pretty quickly this morning. I'm going to do a real quick intro and then dive right in. So my academic background is in library and information science. I went through the University of Michigan's program back when the word library was still in the name of the school. But most of my career has been spent outside the traditional walls of libraries, helping a very wide range of organizations with their information architecture and user experience challenges. Along the way, I've written a number of animal books, information architecture, ambient findability, and search patterns. And my talk today will touch on each of these topics because, as I hope you'll agree, they're all hopelessly intertwined. Now, I might as well get this over with first. There's a lot of noise in our community around defining the damn thing. I happen to think that while there's some negative parts of this, we need to define the damn thing. In fact, I'd go so far as to say that it's central to the future of information architecture. Now, back in the late 90s and early 2000s, in the polar bear books, we took our own stab at defining information architecture. And I think that, you know, many of us still practice forms of this kind of information architecture. But it's no longer the only game in town. There are many different ways to frame the kinds of work that we do. So there's the classic or polar bear information architecture, but we're also now doing web strategy, helping to figure out how web and mobile and social connect. We're doing cross-channel strategy, bridging physical and digital experiences, and we're starting to touch on what I like to call the intertwingularity, ubiquitous computing and ambient findability. And my argument is that all of these futures exist today. As William Gibson might say, they're just unevenly distributed. And I'm going to use some of my recent experiences doing consulting projects to try to show a little bit of how I see this unfolding. So I've been working with the Library of Congress over the last 2 to 3 years on a major redesign of their web presence. And it's been a real honor to work with the library, but our relationship got off to a fairly rocky start. I was invited to do an evaluation of the library's web presence, and I was brutally honest. I compared their web presence to the Winchester Mystery House. Not horrible to look at, but impossible to navigate. And I argued that, you know, these core problems of fragmentation and findability were really creating horrible and often insurmountable problems for their users. Now, this report that I wrote for the library was sufficiently shocking that it was embargoed for a period of time. Nobody was allowed to look at it. It was deemed kind of too politically sensitive and controversial. But over the period of several months, the report percolated throughout the library and made it up to the top levels, where the executive board made a commitment to do a radical transformation of the library's web presence and of the way that the library works on the web. And so I was invited to help them, first of all, formulate a web strategy. And of course, I started out by saying, well, it's not really a web strategy, is it? Because we have to think about mobile and social. We have to think about use cases where physical and digital experiences intertwine. But I worked with the Web Governance Board on a web strategy that sort of began on the back of a napkin and will play out over the period of many years. And then I started doing IA, following the kind of traditional kind of methodology that many of you are familiar with. Now, I would argue that wireframes were the single most visible, tangible, immediately actionable deliverable that I provided to the library. And so I still feel like wireframes are a wonderful tool for communicating with a wide variety of audiences. But I think that some of the more lasting impacts I'll have on the library over time were more in the area of education, helping folks at the library to think differently about what they're doing on the web, to think about points of leverage. What are the components and what kinds of influence do they have? To think differently about search, to recognize that it's far more important than they had recognized, and a lot more interesting and colorful. Now, the library has begun to make some improvements based upon my recommendations, but really it's going to be 2 to 3 years before the vision we've been working towards will be fully realized. What's been really exciting is to see the work that they're doing on the search system. They've taken that lesson to heart and are investing a lot of time and resources in improving site search within the library. And I'd like to sort of at this point just juxtapose this interface with this quote. Actually, it's a paraphrasing of Jorge's article in the Journal of Information Architecture, where he argues that where architects use forms and spaces to design environments for inhabitation, information architects use nodes and links to create environments for understanding. I think that's a tremendously important idea as we think about the future of information architecture. And I would argue that we create these environments for understanding in a couple of different ways. We create environments for understanding for our users. This search interface is a map, right? Faceted search is a way of providing our users with a customized map to their search results. So we're not just helping people to find what they need, we're helping them to understand what they've found. But we're also shaping understanding through the work that we do with our clients and colleagues. We're helping people to understand what's possible. And as the technology gets more and more complex, that role becomes only more important. Also been working with the Kresge Foundation, collaboration with the design firm Q Limited here in Ann Arbor, on a redesign of their website. And I feel like we did a really nice job of taking the website forward a level with respect to the information architecture and user experience. But for me, one of the more interesting parts about this project was helping the foundation to become more comfortable with social media. Now, there's a lot of very smart people at this philanthropy, but many of them are not particularly technology savvy. So I had to contend with questions along the full spectrum from, well, I thought the web is dead, so why do we even need a website? To, the website is everything, so why do we need to worry about social media? It's just a bunch of stuff for kids and teenagers and people with nothing better to do. And so I worked with the foundation to try to explain how the parts relate to the whole, to really articulate sort of the ideas for a multi-channel communication strategy. And it's been really exciting the last several months to start that, to start seeing them use Facebook and Twitter and YouTube and to sort of create new ways of communicating and collaborating with their grantees, the grant seekers, to really improve the way they do philanthropy. I've been working with Dan Klein's firm Tug on project for Macy's. And in this case, we have a very specific focus on the taxonomy and the navigation systems of the website, but it would be a huge mistake to do that work without thinking carefully about how that relates to the sort of multi-channel experience. How does the website relate to the experience of being in a physical Macy's store? How does that work with a mobile device? And I've worked on more exotic projects, did some work for Vodafone, focused on looking at the future of mobile search 3 to 5 years out. Right? Really a lot of fun sort of coming up with sketches and scenarios of how we might be using mobile devices in the future. What I'm getting at here is that already today, our work is no longer just about IA for the web. And to sort of explore these ideas of where things are going, I wrote an article a year or so ago called Ubiquitous Service Design, in which I argued that information is blurring the lines between products and services to create multi-channel, cross-platform, transmedia, physico-digital user experiences. Now, that's quite a mouthful, right? Part of the challenge is that we don't really have the vocabulary to talk about these things yet. They're still very new. But we have this sense that we're seeing this convergence of media and formats and platforms and channels and professions and disciplines into what I like to call the intertwingularity. So we don't have the vocabulary, but we know it when we see it. Right? Apple was one of the first real big success stories in terms of figuring out how do we strike that balance between cross-channel consistency and platform-specific optimization? How do we decide which features belong on which platforms and how they all work together? Now, there's a reason why Apple was first, and that's because they had the world's best information architect. But Apple isn't the only organization or example these days, right? We've got Nike, putting sensors into shoes, turning running from a solitary activity into a social online activity, right? Taking things from conspicuous consumption into conspicuous experience. We've got Zipcar, where the web and mobile platforms are turning cars from products into services. We have mobile devices that are bristling with sensors, and we haven't really quite figured out what to do with them all yet. We have medicine bottles that can track our behavior, make phone calls, and in their own words here, make sure Gramps stays on his meds. And we have smart scales that can tweet our weight. Right? A good reminder that just because you can doesn't mean you should. Now, a while back, I started trying to create this touchpoint taxonomy, try to make sense of all this. And I very quickly realized that's crazy. Right? It's way too complex. You need more of a faceted approach. And the thing is, this is the real world that we live in today. And in the center, we could think of our clients and our users. Right? Well, our job is to make sense of this, to help them make sense of this, to make things easier, to make things, as Dan said, be good. Now, the good news is many of our existing methods and ways of working, tools, are well suited to these tasks. Right? We can adapt our existing methods and tools to these new challenges. But we also need to find new ways of thinking and talking about what we do. This was one of my early attempts to try to come up with what I think Carl calls medium-independent conceptual constructs. He can explain that to you later. But you can check out the blog post if you want to learn a little bit more about this attempt to think about some of the principles that need to lie behind defining a cross-channel strategy. Now, another way we need to change what we do, I'd like to explain through a sort of a story or metaphor. So I've been a long-distance runner for over a decade now, and I've done a couple of marathons. I know how to train for a marathon. You run, and you run, and you run. Okay, but that won't do me much good this fall when I attempt my first half Ironman triathlon. I'll either drown in the lake or crash on my bike. So what I have to do to train for the triathlon is I have to practice sports that I'm not good at, and I have to learn from those who are. And I would argue that that is the challenge that lies for many of us coming from different disciplines and areas of expertise, specialization. We got to leave our comfort zones. We got to cross train. As Dennis said, we have to do this stuff, and we have to collaborate and learn from others. So, you know, my basic argument is all of these futures of information architecture already exist today, and it's a wonderful set of opportunities. We need to keep redefining or reframing what we do to stay flexible. This is a phrase I use for myself to keep myself thinking expansively and flexibly about what I do. I'm an information architect. I map paths and places across physical, digital, and cognitive spaces. Now that kind of helps me, but it's not real useful for most people. I think that for explaining what we do, it's often best to go back to the beginning, back to the basics, right? What architects do for buildings, information architects do for, and you fill in the blank. Now I want to switch gears and talk about a few semi-random topics. First of all, I wrote an article just published very recently in the Journal of Information Architecture called The System of Information Architecture. And it sort of kind of gives you a little hint into my burgeoning love affair with systems thinking. Here's one book I highly recommend, Thinking in Systems, where Danella argues there's a problem in discussing systems only with words. Words and sentences must, by necessity, come only one at a time in linear, logical order. But systems happen all at once. And to discuss them properly, we have to use a language that shares some of the same properties as the phenomena under discussion. I think that's a really important point as we think about the future. And I would argue that we need to go beyond our sitemaps and our wireframes as visual ways of communicating our ideas and designs. We also need to be mapping the customer journey, modeling the system dynamics, and analyzing the impacts on business processes and incentives and the org chart. There's a lot of new and exciting challenges we need to start wrestling with. Okay, switch gears again. In the first Information Architecture Summit in 2000 in Boston, Massachusetts, it was a wonderfully exciting event. There were people from all sorts of backgrounds and disciplines, academics and practitioners. One thing that we all had in common, there was this real strong feeling by the end of the event, was a tremendous amount of empathy for the user. And I think this is one thing that has held true in our community over the years, that we actually really care about creating better experiences and improving satisfaction and happiness and so forth. One of the things I talked about at that first IA summit was Stuart Brand's concept of pace layering, and the idea that in any complex adaptive system, it's important that you can have different layers that can evolve or change at different rates or paces. I think this idea remains really important. Information architects need to think carefully about time. So one example, I worked with the National Cancer Institute back in 2003 on a redesign of the cancer.gov website. And one of the things I find really interesting, a little humbling, is almost a decade later, there have been a number of visual refreshes, the content has been updated, and yet the information architecture is essentially the same. Okay? Sometimes things change a lot more slowly than we might expect. Okay, another example. A couple years back, Dan gave a wonderful talk called The Nature of Information Architecture, in which he showed this photograph of Richard Saul Wurman's sandcastles. Right? Before he was an information architect, Wurman was an architect, and he designed real buildings that people lived in. Well, the thing that really caught my attention was that Dan kind of had visited this location in the sort of the modern present day, and the sandcastles, as you might imagine, were gone, right? Time has washed them away. And what struck me is I thought, I mean, Richard Saul Wurman, whether you like him or not, has been an incredibly prolific person. I mean, he created the TED conference. He has written and published more books than most people will ever read. He's just a you know, creative powerhouse. And yet, he's lived long enough that most of his creations have begun to fade away. Right? Go ahead and try to buy one of his books. Right? They're out of print. And I think that's something that we should all take to heart. And we should think about what are the things that last, because the thing that, you know, we're still talking about Wurman, right? It's his ideas, his impact on others that will probably outlast most of his physical creations. So some things don't last as long as we might expect, and the vice versa. Now, I can't talk about the future of information architecture without showing this device. Okay, so the brain port is a device to help blind people see. Got these glasses that you wear. You've got a video camera pointing out. The image is recreated on a grid of 400 electrodes that you put on your tongue. Okay. The user feels the shape of the image on their tongue, and within a fairly short period of time, the brain recognizes this as visual information, and you start seeing through your tongue. Okay. Seeing well enough to drive a car, to shoot baskets. Now, I like to use this as an example to remind us that the future isn't just about multi-touch. Right? It's about the cross-sensory intertwingling of inputs and outputs in ways that are hard to even imagine. Right? It's about synthetic synesthesia. There's a lot of weird stuff that's going to come our way that, again, we have a hard time even imagining. Now, I'm not crazy about the divisiveness of these sorts of quotes, but I include this one just to kind of hammer home the idea that long after our information architectures, our websites are gone, the biggest impact, the longest impact that we're going to have is going to be through teaching, through how we influence one another. Right? People live longer than most Fortune 500 corporations. Right? So the effect that we have on one another will endure. I want to wrap up by remembering a few questions that I used to ask when I was a student at the University of Michigan's School of Information. I was trying to figure out, what am I going to do with the rest of my life? One of the questions I kept asking at this time of change was, what can't be automated? Okay. A little bit later on, I might have asked the similar question, what won't be outsourced? And I kept asking, what's really interesting? Right? Where's the beef, intellectually speaking, in this discipline? And asking those questions over and over the course of a couple of years led me to information architecture. Now, I'm getting older, and the questions I ask are changing. And one of the questions that I ask a lot these days is what matters? What's really important? How can I make the best positive impact? How can I make the world a better place? And what's really nice is that asking these newer questions still brings me back to the same place. And so I'd like to conclude by saying I think there's never been a better time to be an information architect. Thank you for your attention.